Nuclear bombs are the most destructive weapons humanity has ever devised, but they do have an unexpected upside. Thanks to their development and testing, they've contributed to some surprising advances in other scientific fields, like neuroscience and climatology. You may wonder what neuroscience has to do with nuclear weapons, and to understand the connection, you need to know about carbon-14. Usually, carbon has an atomic mass of 12, 6 protons and 6 neutrons. But on occasion, neutrons energized by cosmic rays from our sun will collide with nitrogen atoms in our atmosphere, knocking a proton off the atom and converting nitrogen into carbon with 2 extra neutrons, aka carbon-14. Unlike its 6 neutron cousin, carbon-14 is radioactive, with a half-life of about 5,700 years. To organisms, though, it doesn't actually make much difference. Plants will use carbon-14 like any other carbon during photosynthesis. And that is how carbon-14 works its way through the food chain. That's right, all of us have this radioactive isotope spread throughout our entire bodies. Since carbon-14 is constantly decaying and is replenished by natural cycles, the amount of it in our atmosphere remains fairly constant. At least, it should. So long as nobody's, you know, I don't know, setting off massive explosions that release a lot of high-energy neutrons into our nitrogen-rich atmosphere. Remember? Because we did that. Atomic bombs create an artificial spike in atmospheric carbon-14, and we can associate that spike to an exact moment in time. Since we know how much carbon-14 was in the air for any given year, and we know how carbon works its way into our bodies, we can use these spikes to measure how much carbon-14 is in a cell's DNA and determine what year that exact cell was formed. Clever scientists realized this gave them a rare opportunity to answer a vexing question about the human brain. The prevailing wisdom had long been that humans don't grow new brain cells after early childhood, but research on rodents and monkeys showed that that wasn't the case for them. These animals grow new neurons in the hippocampus and olfactory bulb, areas associated with memory and smell. But the method to track neuron growth in monkeys couldn't be used on humans because it relied on a banned chemical. So instead, in a small study, researchers looked at samples of brain tissue and checked how much carbon-14 was present. From that, they could determine when the neurons formed during that person's lifetime. At first, they couldn't test the hippocampus because it just contained so few neurons, making carbon-14 too difficult to detect. But their initial tests on the larger olfactory bulb showed that we humans don't generate new olfactory neurons like our smellier monkey cousins. But soon after, advances in DNA sampling did make it possible to scan the hippocampus of 110 brain slices for carbon-14, and voila! They found the average neuron in that region of the brain was only 20 to 30 years old, even when the brain could be more than 90. It would seem that we do generate new neurons in the hippocampus after all, about 700 a day by the researchers' estimate. So, case closed, right? We're done here? Of course not. A study published in early March went looking for those new informing neurons in 59 different brains, and while they were abundant in the brains of children, nary an immature brain cell was found in adults, challenging the results of the experiments that relied on carbon-14. Maybe there's another explanation for the carbon-14 levels, but if we're gonna find it, we better hurry, because the window to test something like this is closing. Open-air atomic testing was banned in 1963, and carbon-14 levels are fast approaching their old pre-atomic levels. By 2050, researchers believe that this sort of carbon-14 testing probably won't be possible anymore. You may remember that carbon-14 has a half-life of almost 5,700 years, and wondering why the levels are dropping so fast. Hasn't been that long since the 60s. It turns out much of the excess carbon-14 is being absorbed by oceans and organisms, which has helped scientists understand how atmospheric CO2 flows. So, in an unexpected way, nuclear weapons have helped us learn about our planet and about our own bodies. I guess even mushroom clouds have silver linings. Before we knew about C14, we could track cell growth with bromodeoxyuridine, but it was banned because it can cause harm to fetuses in pregnant women. That causes us to question all our results. Thanks for watching Seeker.